respect to the ethics of dealing with Allah and His chosen messenger, and how believing men and women should act toward each other by doubting and rejecting gossip from wicked, evil people, and not insulting, mocking, insinuating, or calling others by names that they do not like. Today we continue to talk again about this surah, to learn that living an Islamic life means harboring goodwill and love towards others, guaranteeing privacy of others, safeguarding them from backbiting, and instructing people to treat each other with respect, whether they are present or absent. And nobody should be harmed because of unfounded suspicions. And individual privacy are guarded, and the security and dignity of others are not defiled by spying or backbiting, and their freedom are not infringed upon. This fifth etiquette is contained in verse 12 of Surah Al-Hujurat. Allah says, "O you who believe, avoid much suspicion. Verily, some suspicion is a sin. And spy not on each other, nor speak ill of each other behind their backs. Would any of you like to eat the flesh of his dead brother? You would abhor it. But fear Allah, for Allah is the one who gives and accepts repentance, and Allah is the most merciful." Dear brothers and sisters, the verse starts with the same previous clause and previous verses, by appealing to the faith inside people. So it starts by all you believe. This call is repeated for the fifth time in the surah because the purpose of the instruction that follow is different from the other verses, and to make people pay attention to the instructions. This verse addresses bad hidden interactions with others. Some actions, like spying and backbiting, are done behind a person's back, and he might not be aware to be able to change or stop these actions. While other actions, like suspicion, are inside the person that is coming, that is committing the sin, and only Allah knows it. The first instruction of the verse is to avoid suspicion. So what is meant by suspicion in this verse? And what is needed, what is meant by much suspicion? Suspicion that needs to be avoided is made up of internal thoughts and judgments of the heart against a specific person or against an event without any evidence or proof supporting these thoughts and judgments. This suspicion leads the heart to form bad judgment and ill thoughts towards others based on unfounded signs or imaginations caused by a word or a movement or an action that can be interpreted in many different ways. The verse starts with the warning of suspicion because it leads to other actions like mockery and ridicule, as a person committing these actions thinks that he is better than others and thinks that the ones he ridicules are beneath him. Also, suspicion leads people to spying on each other, and that is why scholars said that suspicion is the main driver for the rest of the sins that are listed in this verse. Scholars said that the reason for forbidding suspicion is that only Allah knows what is in the hearts. And the one that suspects others thinks that his knowledge of hearts is similar to Allah's knowledge. So a person can only suspect and mistrust others if there is a clear evidence or action or saying that is not subject to interpretation. So anything that has not been witnessed or heard by a person but left suspicion in his heart needs to be rejected, because its source is the devil, who is the worst of the evildoers, as Allah told us. and disproof, and between truth and falsehood. This order came so people would not believe themselves prey to these thoughts and mistrust of others. Also, we need to learn that the verse is forbidding much suspicion, which does not imply that a little suspicion is permissible. Since the verse does not specify an amount of suspicion, the Muslims are warned to be careful of any amount of suspicion, and to ponder if their suspicion is based on facts and proofs or none. Because most times, suspicion is baseless, resulting from the human nature of following desires. And since avoiding suspicion goes against human nature, then it needs effort and strive to be accomplished. Also, suspicion that is based on facts is rare, which cannot be used to make judgments or values. So the instruction was to avoid most of the suspicion. Dear brothers and sisters, Quran explained the reason for avoiding suspicion because it is a sin and guilt. So the instruction is for a Muslim to be merciful with himself by avoiding falling into sins that lead to ailment of the heart and wrenching of the soul by becoming suspicious and fearful of his brothers. A person that ponders the verses of the Quran finds out that suspicion is commended in many verses. Suspicion was mentioned 56 times in the Quran. 49 of them were condemned and had the meaning of accusation and doubt. While it was praised 8 times, and one time it was associated with a dying person, which was in Surah Al-Qiyamah, verse 28. Allah says, 28 verse 30, Allah says, and he suspects what the meaning of he realizes that is the time for departure. And one leg will be joined with another, then on that day it is to your Lord that one has to be driven. This is accounting of the verses that include this word indicate that doubt or suspicion is condemned in most circumstances, and that since some doubt is a sin, then a conscious Muslim needs to be to start by avoiding all suspicions, because he does not know if the circumstances of his suspicion are founded or allowed. Dear Muslim brothers and sisters, the reason for condemning doubt and suspicion so much is because it could result in negative actions like spying and mocking and backbiting, or it can stay as doubt in the hearts, and both lead to a major social evil, and that is what we will continue our discussion next time on the incident of killing Jordanian pilot by what they call themselves the Islamic State, and we all had the news about burning him alive. So we are filled with grief and sorrow about this, for this painful incident and the horrific murder of this pilot, and the treacherous actions by the Khawarij of this time. To be updated with the current events, we need to be certain that our faith is innocent of these actions. There's one document with the consensus of all Muslim scholars that our Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam forbade burning a living human or animal. As he said in a hadith, only the Lord of the fire punishes with fire. Another narration that the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was upset with some companions that burned a nest of ants so they can camp in that location. So he said to Allah Subhanahu wa Taala, only Allah punishes with it. Only the creator of fire punishes with fire. What's important is to understand the justification that these misguided individuals give to others, to other Muslims. They claim that they were following the example of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu. And they claim that there is a story that Abu Bakr burned a man, his name is Al-Fujar al-Sulami, because he killed many Muslims. This story is false and is propagated by other misguided groups and was publicized by their likes or media people to distort Islam. This false story was mentioned in some history books without historic account and was mentioned without any authentication from the Sunnah of the Prophet or the Sunnah books. Even the false story in the history books mentions that Abu Bakr regretted his action before his death. So this is a false story, and the false story says that before Abu Bakr died, he regretted killing this man by burning him alive. So if they believe this false story, why didn't they act according to the regret of Abu Bakr, which was, according to this false story, his last action? Which means that this false story says that even if he did that, he didn't want, he regretted doing it. What this indicates is that these people have six souls, and they follow the instructions of the devil, and then try to cover it with the cover of the Quran and Sunnah of Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, while the Quran and Sunnah is far from them. So do not listen to them or follow their views. And our topic about suspicion that we're talking about, so we don't repeat what they say, because all what they say are lies. And have trust in your faith, because Islam is the only faith that's the gap between mercy and justice. So trust your faith and don't trust these lies. You know, don't believe any of their claims of being an Islamic state or they're following the Sharia of Islam. And look at their actions. Look at the actions that they do. They kill innocent people. And we grieve for every soul, whether it's a Muslim soul or a non-Muslim soul. But this is horrific. No Muslim does that. But again, like the man said, this is something that the media is taking. And if you watch the news, now people are saying Islam has a crisis, Islam has has a reformation inside it. How can you tell the right version of Islam? We know the right version of Islam. Anything that follows the Sunnah of the Prophet Islam and the Quran, that's it. Anything that doesn't follow that, that's not the true Islam. So again, the Imam concluded by saying, if you want knowledge, you have to come to the mosques to learn knowledge. All of these people, they had their own teachers. They didn't come to mosques. So, as we always say, we have lectures, we have an imam, you can ask questions, but this is the place to get knowledge, true knowledge about Islam.